amazing team. I don't think I've had the chance to actually thank you, but they're amazing. Anyway, this evening's topic is quite personal to me. I was raised by strong women, supported by enlightened men. I have to say that, my father's in the office. My grandmother gave me a book about Marie Curie when I was 7. And I met successful Filipinas from diverse fields, including a grand aunt, who is an amazing writer and wrote a book entitled Woman Enough and Other Essays. I grew up believing I could do anything until I entered the finance world in the 90s in the US with a degree from a Philippine university. It was then when I had to dig deep and muster all my confidence and find mentors who would guide me to persevere and succeed. My 7-year-old, who's actually here tonight, and I'm so glad Anna brought her daughter as well. They have more resources like websites such as amightygirl.com and books like these, Good Night Stories for Rebel Girls. This is a kind of compilation of 100 biographies of women from Cleopatra to Michelle Obama, specifically for young girls. And there's a second volume, by the way, already. And yet, while there are more resources available and more people are aware about gender inequality, we still need to work on it. We need to keep the conversation moving and disrupt the remaining seeming status quo. This is what we will be doing here tonight. So I want to thank every one of you for being here, our daughters, our mothers, who are here this evening with us, and among you who are sisters and friends, and the men who supported us. We are going to be talking about a very important conversation, especially in these very challenging times. To begin this evening, I would like to introduce Ms. Georgina Hernandez-Young, Head of the Advocacy and Anti-Poverty Programs Unit, Office of the Vice President. Thank you for that.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you, Suyen, for the invitation and the opportunity to also share some thoughts on our topic this evening. I'm Georgina Hernandez-Young. I'm the Head of the Anti-Poverty Program, President Lenny Robredo called Aunt Nuhay, and I also serve as her spokesperson. But I believe tonight it will really be more about my thoughts on the topic for this evening. As already mentioned, that we are really in challenging times today, particularly for women, not just in the Philippines, but it seems that misogyny and other patient is still ongoing all over the world, different platforms, even on social media. In the Philippines in particular, we already ranked 7th in the Global Gender Gap Report of 2016. Unfortunately, we dropped 3 notches, so we're now just down to 10th in the Global Gender Gap Report, and we're just really trying to reflect on this reality and see what went wrong and how we can address this as a country. Right now, 50% unemployment in among women compared to only 50% of women today have access to jobs, compared to 80% of men who have access to jobs. So there really is still that imbalance in terms of accessibility. Of course, another issue is in terms of progressing in one's career once you're inside of the corporate world. In my experience, I used to work. I've worked with government for about 7 years. The question about typical gender roles and gender bias. I work with the Department of Social Welfare and Development. It's mostly women in the organization, which made me actually think why hasn't there been a male DSWB secretary? And just for this evening's thoughts, perhaps it would be a good time to see a male heading at the SWD, just so to say that perhaps we've seen beyond typical gender roles in our country. And I was, of course, younger then, and I would do a lot of partnerships. So I would meet with a lot of private sector individuals, vice presidents of different corporations, and of course, they would expect to meet someone senior and perhaps even a male counterpart when they would see me and really just start thinking if they should continue talking to me. I mean, I've experienced that too. And then sometimes my strategy would be for me to bring a male senior looking colleague, even if I am the one authorized, and just to really set up a good rapport. And for most of us, we all have similar stories like this, and for women in the workplace, whether in the public or in the private sector, I really think it's a tough balancing act. And what I've found so far is the importance of really knowing one's core. There are a lot of stereotypes still, but if you're able to really handle who you are, what you can be good at, and these stereotypes are already just a given. It's something that we really just have to work with, but eventually still bring out our individuality, regardless of gender, regardless of age, regardless of class or color or religion. And that's what I really am advocating for in the workplace, both in the public and private sector. And in our office, we partner with a lot of private organizations to push for women economic empowerment. We are also closely coordinating with different efforts in the private sector, such as the Investing in Women that was launched last year to address, improve the quality of workplaces for women. And I think this will just be the beginning of a continuous conversation between the public and the private sector, and I think for each of us in our journey in our different careers. So thank you very much again for this opportunity.
Thank you so much. So with that, I'd like to introduce our moderator this evening, Ms. Lala Rimando. Lala has been a business journalist for almost 2 decades, focusing on corporate governance, political economy, and other issues on capitalism in a developing country. She's currently writing a book on conglomerates, including the families that control a major slice of and influence the fate of the Philippine economy. Please welcome Lala.
Leading systems integrator and technology innovator in the Philippines,
representing the top U.S. and China technologies like Huawei, IBM, Dell, Apple, and HP. She was Ernst & Young's first woman entrepreneur of the year in 2003 and was named one of the 10 outstanding women in nation service in 2010. A round of applause for Maya. Next is Maan Montiveros. Please join us. Maan is the chairperson of Philippines Air Asia Inc. She was a pioneer in TV broadcasting and former journalist, publishing executive, multimedia production, corporate communications entrepreneur, and an advocate for the conservation of Filipino arts and culture. She was named one of the 100 most influential Filipino women in the world in 2014 and 2016, and has been recognized for her outstanding achievement for public service by the Armed Forces of the Philippines and for the liberation of People's Television 4 during the People Power Revolution in 1987. She also received a Quill Award for the documentary film The Benigno Aquino Story, Freedom from Fear in 1987. Our next is Elizabeth Lee. Ms. Lee was Universal Motors Corporation's Chief Operating Officer for 12 years, the youngest and the first female president of the Chamber of Automotive Manufacturers of the Philippines, and is currently the president and only female co-founder of eMotors. eMotors was the chosen green electric mobility partner of APEC 2015 and received several awards, including the Business Asia Green Entrepreneurship Award and the Asia CEO Green Company of the Year. She's also the founder, president, and co-host of the business and public affairs television show, Biz News TV. Okay. Another round of applause for Ms. And the last but not least is Anna Green. Anna is the country chief executive officer, CEO of ANZ Banking Group in the Philippines. She was formerly the CEO of ANZ Lao and has experience in dealing with international development multilaterals such as the World Bank and the United Nations, among others. Anna was the founding member of the Australian ASEAN Chamber of Commerce, as well as headed Australian Chamber of Commerce in Laos. Before working in ANZ Bank, Anna was an international banker who practiced financial law at leading international law firms in UK and Australia, as I learned a while ago, also in Taiwan. All right, so another round of applause to our I'm going to give them a name this time. Coming over, I said, okay, we have women of altitude. Yes.
Not attitude.
Okay, we'll do it like this. If you'll indulge me, I'll ask the first set of questions, and then I'll turn over the mic to the audience so they can also ask their own questions. So, let me find the first one. Okay, so women of altitude essentially gives the impression that you did start from the top. You started somewhere. And being women, can you just give us a warm up? You know, what were the challenges that you've encountered on your way to the top? Perhaps Anna can give us the first salvo.
Thank you so much. And first of all, I want to say a very big thank you to the Asia Society for bringing this pretty amazing and impressive panel of women together for this conversation tonight. I would say, first and foremost, that these type of conversations are essential for women in the community to understand that there are opportunities for women. It's not easy, and I think it's incumbent upon all of us to be honest about our experiences. And so to your question, what are some of the challenges that I faced along the way? Well, one of my favorite stories is when I started as a lawyer at a large corporate law firm in Sydney. I had spent many, many years studying to become a lawyer and really invested my heart and soul in that, and was so excited at the prospect of having my first job as a graduate lawyer. And on my very first day, my senior partner, who was an older man, took me aside, and I was very excited to get my first piece of work. And his request for me was, can you please go and take this and get my dry cleaning?
Oh my.
And it was the very first thing that he asked me to do. And so I reflect on that day, and I remember how disheartened I felt. I just thought, my goodness me, I've done all of this study, and I'm about to go and get an old man's dry cleaning. But as I said, it's very important, I think, for all of us to be honest about the experiences we have. And so from that point onwards, my life and my career has been littered with those type of challenges. And what I try to do, in a lot of instances, those type of challenges are not meant to be offensive. Sometimes, we are dealing with people who are carrying what they believe to be unconscious bias with respect to women. And the reality is they come from a different generation. So, you know, I think for me, and it's different for other people, and it's different, I think, for this generation, it's about behaving sensitively towards that behaviour, calling it out, but doing it in a way that doesn't create a divide in a workplace scenario. So making sure that you make people aware that it's not appropriate, but doing it in using a sense of humour to deal with that type of situation, for instance. So I would deal with that differently today than I did when I was a 22-year-old lawyer. And I hope that didn't go on too long. But one thing I did want to say is I wanted to thank our first speaker today. I really found what you said inspirational, simply because you represent a generation of women that, you know, I'm ahead of. But I was so pleased to hear just your confidence and your sense of self. And there's no way I could have stood up and spoken as you, so as confidently as you did when you stood up here. So I want to commend you for that and tell you to keep doing it.
Industry male dominated, yet you were the youngest, as I mentioned in your profile a while ago, you were the youngest and the first. You actually are very well known for heading CUMPI, which is the industry association. You've made strides over there. Now you're in a different, still related, but a different, I don't want to say field, but essentially you're talking to a different set of stakeholders. Can you just walk us through first, how it was dealing with men in the traditional automotive industry? You were with Nissan, with the Nissan manufacturing group then, and you were dealing with other men, and you know, I'm sure they're so macho all over. Is it? I mean, fast forward to 2018, are the challenges you face then still present now? And can you share with us how you were able to overcome?
I think, actually, thank God, it's really different now. And I was chatting with Ma'an here earlier, that as for the Philippines, you know, we're very lucky because the Philippines actually has already had two female presidents, when the United States of America has not had one. Almost, but not quite. So I think we are so lucky as Filipinos to be actually living here in the Philippines. But having said that, we still need to actually, we're met still with headwinds. So when we started with this, and I have to say, it's kind of like a caveat, because that's not the way it is now. But when I started with Nissan, I was actually, the position was EVP, Executive Vice President, and female, so the first one. And so there was this event that we had to go to in Japan. And of course, in Japan, we're more open here in the Philippines and also probably in Australia, New Zealand, and the United States. But at that time, not so much in Nissan. So I remember this big, huge group where we have all the distributors worldwide to Japan to meet. So I'm representing our company here, in the Philippines, and the only female, actually. So we were going into this big, huge hall room. Everyone was in a dark suit and all male. So here I am in a red jacket, and the only female going there. And then the guy said, stop. I said, what more bread, because I knew that I was going to stand out. So that when they started the speech, it was lady and gentleman, because I was the only girl. So I really felt really, you know, proud at that time, representing also the Philippines. So fast forward to the campy, I was very blessed that the you know, Filipino were blessed, because Filipino men are all gentlemen, majority. And I was really, you know, really blessed also. But I want to say this one thing. You know, we should really, when I was elected as president of CAMPI, and then there was, for 7 years, you know, re-elected, I didn't start off in the auto industry saying that I'm female and therefore I should work this way. And, no, actually, I didn't even think about gender, I just did it. So I think if there was one key lesson that I learned, is that you don't start off thinking that because I'm female. No, you just do it. Because you're a person, because you're a human being, and you're, God gave you some talent, so you use it. So being elected as president for the chamber was really such an honor, because that meant that your peers, and most of them are much older, actually did support, and then that they believe. But let me tell you this, if you did not perform, there is no amount of being female, charm, whatever it is, that's gonna get you ahead. So it's either, we do have to work double time, we have to work a little bit harder and smarter in order to stay ahead. But you know, now, current now, 2018, you know, women in the auto industry is like a dime a dozen. It's not a big deal. And the climb was actually pretty fast. It's steep, but it's fast. So there's this one, I think one quote by Marianne Williamson, it says that if you let yourself shine, you actually grant the permission for others to do the same. So if you're like my here for aviation, so if people actually can see that, well, she did it, so I can do it. So before, the 4 minute mile was impossible until somebody did it. Now 4 minutes for a mile is slow. So that's one of those things that I think, fast forward to now, at least it's not that big of a deal, thank God, for women to be in certain levels. And then the men, if they are actually solid, and if they have a lot of confidence and they don't have any kind of a complex, they would actually support women who would be trying to actually support. So I think it's not, you know, more of like a gender, male and female, but more of like, you know, for people, and that we support each other more and more. I think now in my industry, the auto industry, it's getting to be that way. Now I'm doing electric vehicles, electric tricycles, three-wheelers. But I'm also, again, the only female and the only social enterprise to do this. But I got all that also, God's blessing, but also from my mom, who's seated right there. Sisters also for towns, and it's, I think now it's the best time for women, actually, men and women, but more so I think for women, to really just put their stake there and just go for it. So it is better now, but we do have challenges, but you kind of like just have to tweak it in such a way that you should not be afraid because you think you're female. Well, that's not a negative. That's a plus. So I hope that answered. It was kind of like long, but sorry, I hope that answered.
Okay, we'll try to dig deep and discuss more details in a bit, but let's go to Maman. Maan, you're in media, used to be in media, and now in aviation. So let's focus on aviation because essentially that's one of the industries that are truly male-dominated. Lots of the statistics show that female participation in aviation, especially for the pilot's position, including the non-pilot and top positions, are still very much male-dominated. You're the chairman of the Philippine unit of what? That mean the biggest. I'm having a difficulty here with the
mic.
Mike, do you mind if I just stand here for a minute? Okay. Anyway, so you're in an industry where you're in a position where you're heading the Philippine unit of the biggest
low cost
carrier in Asia. Can you tell us more about how you got there from being in media and arts all the way to heading, being the first head of the Philippine unit. Sorry, the Philippine unit is the only female-led unit of Air Asia.
Not really. I was the first.
Oh,
I was the first.
Okay.
Filipino
so you
woman.
Were the trailblazer.
Yes, I think it's not your mind. It's my mind.
Ah, okay. Way better?
Yeah.
Let's do this.
Yeah. So, yeah. Nothing in this world is a coincidence. I got to the aviation industry because of my previous work. In fact, my first corporate job was with Warner Music. I set up the Warner Music unit in the Philippines. And the person that actually convinced me to take the job was Tony Fernandez. At that point, I wasn't sure I wanted to jump into the corporate world. I'd always been an entrepreneur. I was producing my own TV show. I was hosting TV programs. I never worked for a corporation. So I wasn't quite sure I was ready to do that jump. But it was a job that was offered to me shortly after President Ramos became president, and I realized that I could not make it in government. Unlike Georgina here, enough to work for government, I wasn't, because knowing my personality, I was afraid I'd get assassinated in 2 weeks. I speak too frankly, and I knew I was gonna, part of the term, piss off a lot of people in government. So I told the President Ramos, I'm sorry, sir, I think for my sanity, I stay in the private sector. But I had already taken leave for 6 months of my work, so I didn't have that vuelo to go back to work for my own company. And this job came along. They asked me, would you like to set up Warner Music in the Philippines? And Time Warner was one of the biggest names in the music industry. And I have a lot of friends who are artists and all that. So I was saying, that might be cool. I went around to take a look at the offices, and I met Tony Fernandez, who was 15 years younger than me. He was running the Warner Music office in Malaysia. And I said, well, tell me about this work. And he says, hey, man, come on. He says, what is cooler than being able to promote your artists throughout the world with the biggest record company in the world? Wouldn't that be something you'd like to do? And he was very convincing. So I said, okay, I'll give it a try. We became fast and close friends. And years later, after I left Warner Music, I went back and started doing other things. For one thing, I was with Newsbreak. You were paying me 1 peso a year to do some marketing and looking for sponsors for Newsbreak magazine. Tony calls me up and says, "Man, what are you doing now? I'm leaving Warner Music." I said, "Well, I'm doing this, I'm doing that." He says, "Save your money, we're going to start an airline." And I go, "Huh?" "Yes," he says, "we're going to set up a low-cost airline. It's going to be an airline that will be all over Southeast Asia." I said, "Wait a minute, what do we know about running an airline?" And he says, "Nothing yet." He says, "But if we can sell records, we can sell airline seats." I said, "Yeah, you have a point there." So that's how I got to my position. When he was ready to start the operations in the Philippines, he called me and said, "Are you ready?" I said, "Well, yes. Now I'm ready. I had just gotten over 5 years of surviving breast cancer and realized I was going to live. So I said, yeah, you know, maybe I can take the challenge now." And so we set up for Air Asia Philippines. So I don't know. It was there. It was kind of something that was offered to me. So I guess I'm one of the lucky ones. I didn't have to start at the beginning. I came in immediately as a shareholder. And during our first board meeting with the partners, we were 4 men and 1 woman. And we decided we were going to vote for who the chairman was going to be. And Tony Kawanko, who's our partner, said, "Well, this is going to be tough. You're going to have to be facing me. Just imaan na lang, you know. Give the job to the woman, it's a tough job." So I became chairman. So we said, "Okay, fine, now we gotta go headhunt for a CEO." "Oh, wait, they said, "CEO, that's a harder position than chairman." Tony said, "Yeah, let's re-vote again." They made me the CEO, and they voted Tony Kawanko in as the chairman. So I was chairman for a day. So I became CEO. I had to do all the hard work of getting the license, you know, getting the permits to operate, hiring people and all that, because they figured, yeah, she's the woman, she can do the job. That's what happened.
And we have a little confidence. Yeah. Okay. Maida, you're in a nonprofit industry, another industry, male-dominated one. While preparing for this event, I actually read up some industry and find my notes, but some industry stories. And among them was this particular study where essentially the Americans were asked who they could name as top female leaders in the industry, in the tech industry. And only something like 8.3% said they could name someone. 8.3. But out of those 8.3, only 4% name a specific female leader. And among the responses were Siri and Alexa.
Oh my goodness.
To me, this goes to show that in your industry, like, they look at women as, you know, as tech assistant. You've been in the movie industry for since the 90s, 30s.
Okay.
That's your story?
Yeah. So nowadays, it's very different from 30 years ago. You have Jimmy Romney, IBM, Whitman, eBay, and HP. I have Ms. Sandberg, right? They're really amazing women in the industry. But 30 years ago, I was watching perhaps some of the material part of watching the rising power person. I was a college student, 20, and about to graduate, and I said, "I want to go back home. I have no family in the Philippines," and so I said, "Sorry, I'm going back home." So I came home alone, because my family was in the U.S., and started a company. Lo and behold, there was nothing but IBM and me. Really old technology, men in blue suits, and it was really shocking because I went to school in Santa Clara where so many innovations were happening. So it wasn't so much being a woman, but being a young woman that was a little unnerving but exciting at the same time.
I had just then turned 21 and started my company. And within maybe, that was in 88, 6 months to a year, I forget the amount of time, the first series of coup attempts happened. 7 of them came at that time. And being a woman, alone, at 21, 22, 23, trying to start your first company was very difficult. My pride wouldn't allow me to go back to the U.S. and say, okay, Pop, I give up on my country. I really just was determined to make it happen. And it was at that time that my mantra was, how do you break down a monolithic company like IBM? Sorry if anyone in IBM, they're my friends now. And decided to bring in young, innovative companies from the U.S. and test out what you would call local area networks. This was before the internet, you know. And then I won, went into my first major bid, entered the bid committee, and they were really so old. And I think they wanted to get over my part because the next item on the agenda for the bid was a helicopter. So that was really cool. It's this local area, okay, we allow you to do it. And this was a big government agency. And then I won the social security system. I was awarded by an 80-year-old man who was a brilliant, you know, CIO at the time. And he trusted that we could break down this major network, mainframes to the centralized system. So from then, we really started to dominate. But we had a bigger problem than these coup attempts. This power crisis started to come in, and we had 12-hour outages. How the heck are you going to do this when there's no power? So it was a series of very big difficulties, but we're 30 now, and I think the spirit of innovation is something that made us different from the rest. But I view things differently, and also in telecommunications, that is more male-dominated than technology at large. And I would enter a room and there are 1,000 men and 4 women. Actually, kind of enjoy them, right? Because you really differentiate yourself. And I think there's nothing more appealing or interesting than a woman who can talk back, right? So I used it to my advantage. I made my name not just here, but in it can be a disadvantage, but it can be a great advantage to be a woman in a field dominated by men. It's so much easier, you know, to in a way, be able to articulate differently and make it a value.
How is it?
Oh, I mean, Every company is probably better, and I think better by having women on boards. It's a big move in the U.S. And even in Southeast Asia. There are many women who occupy CEO and chairmanships in our field, and I think industry is beginning to find it a real value to understand that half of our consumers are women. So I think it's really an advantage that and it's no longer a problem.
I think for this round, we just touched on a couple of themes, including, you know, the past experiences that we've had. Three of our speakers just mentioned the difficulties in the Philippine economy over the under different administrations. You heard about the energy crisis and the coup d'etat. I see a lot of young faces here who may not be able to relate to it. We went through all those difficulties. And but I think for our benefit, we also want to know, you touched about the advantages of being a woman. I'd like to ask, when do you use that advantage of being a woman, and how long does it last, and when does it become a disadvantage? I'd like to start again with Anna, because you're in both finance and previous tattoo in law. You just mentioned being asked to pick up laundry. A lot of the women here are asked to make coffee, basically, when they started. So can you share to us, you kind of touched a bit into it when you said that when you were in your 20s, you handled it differently than how you handled it now.
Sure, and I think, as I said, I really do commend our first speakers. Ability to just stand up and face a crowd and have a conversation about being a young woman. I think things have really changed. And when I reflect on the type of person that I was when I was 22 and I was having those conversations with those senior men, I wish that I had a little bit more confidence and faith in my own capacity. But honestly, that comes with experience. So have there been times in my life where the fact that I'm a woman and I look the way that I do has been an advantage for me from a career perspective? I think probably yes. But that you know, if we're being honest about it, it's around a very old corporate culture, which is outdated and, for me, frustrating. And what I can say, and when I was thinking very much about preparing for this conversation, really, what practical advice do you give to young women when they're thinking about entering the workforce and the difference between being a woman and a man? What I would say is there's probably not as many opportunities that present themselves for women as they do for men. And my career is a case in point. So I'm a lawyer. I am a project finance lawyer. I spent all my time in mahogany boardrooms with senior men in three-piece suits, using BlackBerries, actually. So, a while ago. And watching them behave in a lot of instances like five-year-olds. And so being a woman in that context, having the emotional maturity not to behave like a five-year-old, I think played to my advantage. So I think that's something that women do bring that men perhaps haven't had to, but that's something that's developing. So behaving in a way that is emotionally intelligent to the people who are around the table, understanding that there is more than one type of person who will make a decision in a corporation, and listening to all of those different diverse opinions and honestly listening to them and honestly trying to take them on board when you're making decisions about the future of the company. But the point that I wanted to make about opportunity was this. I use it as a case in point because it's really, people often say to me, how are you a bank CEO? You know, I went back to Australia last week, and Australia, you may be interested to hear this, is the most masculine corporate culture in the world. More so than Russia. Yeah, I know, and if you've met any Russian businessmen, you'll understand why that's a big deal. So I went back and I met, senior stakeholders. In fact, the Secretary for Foreign Affairs and the Secretary for Finance from Philippines were both there. Lovely, incredibly smart, diplomatic gentlemen. So it was a pleasure to deal with them. The Australian men, however, were a challenge for me because I would introduce myself to them. And they, honestly, I would say 5 out of 7 responses when I introduced myself. My name's Anna Green. I'm the CEO of ANZ Bank in the Philippines. And their response was, good for you. I honestly don't know what to say to that. Because I'm like, what do you mean, good for you? Good luck? Like, how did that happen? Great. And this what I was talking about with the reference point, which is that, and again, they did not mean to be offensive, but it really is fundamentally offensive to say to someone, that was lucky, how did that happen? You know, essentially, which is the message that they were giving me. And I can tell you how it happened. I spent the first 15 years building a career in law and in banking. So the bones of my technical expertise are in law and are in banking. It took my friend sending me an email for the chief risk officer for ANZ in Laos. Now, I don't know if many of you know where Laos is, but I can tell you that of the 153 countries that Transparency International uses, it is the 147th most difficult place to do business. And what that means is it's an extremely risky place to do business. So my friend sent me a job description for the chief risk officer for ANZ Bank in Laos as a joke. And said, it was joking serious. But the email said, oh my goodness, who would do this job? And I read it, and because obviously I'd had some experience working in developing markets, I'd also been a finance lawyer, I knew about banking and risk. I looked at that people in Australia who lived a very happy, suburban, safe life would never have looked at. I went home to my husband and I said, this is an opportunity. And honestly, from that point, it's just been onwards and upwards for me, because it was such a moment in time in which I thought to myself, this is a risk, and it was risky. I moved my beautiful children and my husband to a country that has no medical, none. You have to catch an ambulance an hour and a half to go to get medical help. And what I realized when I say that is that the entire country of Laos has to do that, not just me and my family. So it also taught me an amazing gift. It gave me an amazing gift of humility and understanding other people's cultures and understanding just how incredibly intelligent and capable those people were, the challenging situation that they had to do business every day. So I'm sorry to labour the point, but really I think what I'm trying to say is it is still challenging for women to progress, and you must look at opportunities when they come up and try and look at them differently. You know, it might look risky, but honestly, had I not taken that job, I would not have been experienced enough to run a full service international bank by myself with nobody teaching me or helping me. And so when somebody says to me, good on you, well done, I can stop them at that point and say, yep, thank you, and I appreciate that, but also, I spent 5 years of my life to become the CEO of ANZ in the Philippines, and I'm fully qualified to do the job, so thank you. Just working 3 days a week and playing tennis. Really, or something like that. Yes. But no, that was not my choice. And I'm really glad I didn't make that choice, because I would not be sitting with you lovely people here tonight. I would not have the gift of being able to show my daughter that, you know, if you're a woman, it doesn't really matter. You can do it. You've got to take chances, and it's worth it.
May I just add to what you said? I remember when I first took the job in Warner Music, it never occurred to me that I was the first woman managing director of the music company in Asia, until I started receiving all the internal emails from all the women all over the world saying, bravo, you know, you made it as the managing director. There was only one other female managing director in all of Warner Music, and she was from Finland, I think, or Sweden. And of all the brands that Warner Music represented, which was Elektra, Atlantic, Warner Brothers, etc.,
the World of Music International, ERATO, there was only one woman who headed the corporation. So we were a rarity, and it was only then that I said, oh wow, I'm the first. And then fast forward to the airline industry. So when my four male partners decided that the job was too difficult for them to do and threw the job at me, I had to really beef up on all of the aviation policies, all of the rules and regulations. The aviation industry is one of the most regulated in the entire world, and rightly so, because people's lives are dependent on us flying everything safely and adhering to standards. So I read all of the manuals, you know, from flight operations to ground operations and everything. It was just really, really like working for your final exam. So I get to the Civil Aeronautics Board hearing, and we are, of course, being opposed. Our operation is being opposed by Philippine Airlines and Cebu Pacific. And there we are at the hearing, and one of the lawyers, I won't mention which airline, had the temerity to say, and Ms. Ontiveros, what qualifies you to be the CEO of an airline? My lawyer kicked me under the table because he could see my handcuffs going up, and he kicks me. And what I wanted to say was, if I were a man, you would never dare ask me that question. If I were Lance Gokongwei, you would never ask me that question. What did he know about the airline industry? Before that, they were in food, right? Food and real estate. What did Lucio Tan know about running an airline when he was in tobacco and beer and other drinks? And yet, because I was a woman, he dared to challenge my credentials. But with my lawyer kicking me under the table, I stopped, I didn't say that. You know, those thought bubbles that go there. Instead, I started rattling out my experience. And I said, and I've read every single manual on aviation. And then he said, he followed up. So who hires the pilots? I said, I hire the pilot. You know, I'm the CEO. And he says, and by what standards? And again, my eyes rolled up, you know. And I said, well, you know, they have to have their licenses. We can look up their record. We give them tests on the simulator. I said, I have a panel of other pilots who interview them. And they, we rate them. But I had to do it in a very calm manner because they expect us as women to get emotional. And I said, I'm not going to let this guy get over me. And then, as you said, always do it with a sense of humor. So after I rattled all the things that you look for in a pilot, and I said, and of course, they have to be good looking. Which was just my way of saying, you want to be sexist, I can be sexist too. So you come across this all the time. When things like this happen, you need to call it out, right? Because you can't accept it. But at the same time, you have to make sure that it doesn't get you to a bad position. Because as they say, ang pikon talo.
First female and the youngest female in the auto industry, also for the chamber for Hampi. I think that really was a, first it's a blessing, but it's also a great opportunity because at that time, I was also very vocal. So you attract a lot of attention because you are female, because you're different. They're all male and you're the only female. So obviously the females would be more attractive. So you attract a lot of attention. And also, you have to do your homework.
Yes.
Similar to what you did, the present, you know, it's results that matter. But being charming, if you have, there's nothing wrong with that. You know, looking good, there's nothing wrong with that. You do take that to your advantage. And so you attract a lot of attention, but you also, when you attract attention, you better do your homework. So what I did was, I did have a team with me. But I did study. So we, the auto industry at that time was going through a lot of problems. Smuggling was very, very rampant. So at that time, it was 60-40, 60% in favor of smuggling, smuggled vehicles that's being dumped here in the Philippines. And only 40% were here, were legitimate. So at that time, when I was a president for 7 years, we really did fight for the anti-smuggling law. And that, there's a lot of money in there. So being, and I'm also, you know, my mom taught me integrity is non-negotiable. So there is no under the table. Even if somebody kind of throws out a trial balloon to see, well, you know, it costs $10 million per judge. And I said, I didn't understand that. So sometimes you would use your being female to say, sorry, I don't know. So sometimes you do use that, kind of like, I do understand, but you know, what am I doing? I'm sorry. But you know, that's how I kind of, you know, use it without being so hard that the person who was kind of throwing out the trial balloon would get, you know, because the one who was throwing it out wasn't male. So I just kind of had to say, you know, like, I didn't really, you know, understand what we do. So, but long story short, with God's blessing, without paying one single cent, one single penny, one single, you know, 1 cent, the automotive industry actually won that argument. We have an anti-smuggling law specifically for the auto industry, and that was a big win. And so I think in order for us to sort of like balance, we do have to stand our ground, but we also use our femininity or womanness in the correct way. And I think also when we can understand better, empathize better, men do so too also, but then I think we listen more and empathize more. So I think that is a big plus. But don't let that be like the end all and be all, but you really do need to study, you need to learn, fast and not be so offended sometimes when it's all men, they can't help it. So when they start talking, it's like, I'm a big gorilla. No, I'm a bigger gorilla. No, my mother was the biggest gorilla. I mean, kind of like, you know, sometimes they'll forget, but then one person would go, hey, we have to be, you know, there's some woman in the room, so we have to behave. So sometimes I would be the one to say, hey guys, behave. You know, so let's finish this and then let's go out, then I'll leave you guys and you guys can go play, whatever. So that's the five-year-old thing. But you know, but still, this is a tape or camera. But you know, all the members of Camp B, they come from different countries. They come from Japan, they're Americans. I mean, it was really such a privilege. I also learned a lot from them. So I think also being female is a great advantage, especially when you're surrounded by men who are accomplished and do not have a chip off their shoulder. They also want to help you and they also teach you. So I learned a lot from them and I'm so, you know, honored and privileged to be part of that. And I think that's one of the reasons also, if we're balanced and we're fair and we show that we are fair, they will support by voting you. And that's one of the reasons why I was voted for 7 years in a row until I until I resigned to do something else, which is this one. So I think you do stand your ground, can use your womanness and femininity in a good way, but you know, balancing it out also with giving respect. I think that's the main thing. It really is respect both ways. So if you stand your ground in a good way, the men respect you, so that they also.
We have the last 5 minutes, so I think one of the, I'll answer it a little differently, and I'll take off maybe from the point of understanding and empathy. I think what we as women have used experiences that I have used throughout my career to create wonderful products, right, that, you know, emanate from that experience of being a woman. I've had 5 startups, and I think that's also something unique in my career, and there are not many women entrepreneurs who are of the startup mentality. But one of the most fulfilling for me was one of the companies that was acquired by Smart called Meridian Telecoms. And it was, in a way, my grandmother who really influenced how that product came to be. As I was growing up, she had a store in a rural area, a large sari store, but nonetheless it was. She was a real entrepreneur. She was the distributor of Magnolia, of the Girl Scouts uniforms, etc. And that's when I saw how a mother and a caretaker really works hard at the business in order to provide for family, etc. At the time that I started Meridian, the internet just came to be. And I thought, wonderful if we can connect rural sari-sari stores and communities and allow women of the sari-sari store, many of them are women, to create new jobs, maybe provide internet cafes to the rural communities and really be emancipated by the knowledge that the internet would bring to them. And while that was tough, I think it was very fulfilling, and it was really that experience of being in a rural environment, watching the women in my family and the entrepreneurial spirit come to be in the products that I make. And I can name many different products that became hits in the market as a result of my experiences as a woman that I don't think would be there had I been a man, you know, quite honestly. So I think that if for the younger women in the group, look at it as a big differentiator and as an advantage. We have women's instincts, and mostly it really is helpful to listen to that once in a while, balanced with study and research, and you'll make a name for yourselves just being true to that. And of course, I agree with you, there's nothing more important than integrity along the way. So with that, I'd like to say this is an admirable set of women, and I really enjoyed your stories. And to the younger people here, choose a mentor and choose a woman. It'll really make a difference in your careers.
We're not saying goodbye yet. Okay. We'll open the floor to questions from the audience. Do you have any burning issues or, you know, concerns or questions that you'd like to throw to our speakers here? Raise your hand. And oh, there's a lady at the back. Can you give your name?
Yeah. Hi guys, my name's Sarah. I'm actually a videographer.
Peace.
recently started my own video production company, and I once shot for Air Asia, actually.
Oh, really?
Yes, I love the people behind the marketing team. Yeah. My question is for all of you, touching up on the topic of being emotional as women, how do you make use of that to your advantage, more specifically?
Emotion.
Yes.
Straight on
to the emotional one. I'm very lucky that my partners are all very enlightened men, very comfortable around women. As a matter of fact, in Air Asia, we have a lot of women in senior positions, and they do encourage the women. But they're not perfect. So let me tell a story about Tony Fernandez, for instance. When we moved out of Clark, I was really fighting to keep one more aircraft in Clark. And he turned to me at the board meeting and says, "Man, why are you so emotionally attached to Clark?" And I shot back at him. I said, "Why is it, Tony Fernandez, that when I fight for something, you say I'm being emotional? When you fight for something, you say you're being passionate." I said, "What's the difference here, right?" And he said, "Yeah, you're right." So actually, the emotional part of a woman is sometimes to our advantage, because we are more, I think we're more instinctive. We're more collegial in our work style. We try to be more inclusive, and there are things sometimes that we spot as women that men don't. So don't be afraid of that label of being emotional, except when you're facing an opponent. Never let your opponent get the better of you. And I think it's fine. I mean, call it out. So when people think that you're being too emotional, you know, stop for a while and you say, "Yeah, but are you listening to what I'm saying? Am I right?" Right? That's all I can say.
I would add to that, I had a fantastic female leader prior to me as a CEO and now. And one of the things that she used to do on a regular basis is that when she did not feel happy, she would call me into her office and she would actually say, "I'm probably on the verge of tears right now, and I just need to have a quick talk with you about just something, anything." She was just very good at managing her own emotional state. And what that meant was that whatever situation she found herself with emotionally, that never had an impact on her team. So I learned from that, and I make sure that if I'm ever being driven by a particular emotional state when I come into the office, which quite frequently I am, thank you to this young lady here who from time to time doesn't pack her school bag, which makes me feel sometimes a little bit frustrated, but also very loving, which means that I'm going into the office maybe not in the best state emotionally, which means I need to check that at the door. It doesn't mean I need to check it at the door, it just means I need to acknowledge it and deal with it before it has an impact on you know, the decisions that I make in a day-to-day work environment. And I would say also being honest about where your emotional state is at and being aware of it really does help when you're dealing with other people in the office. I'm not suggesting you should burst into tears whenever you're in a situation that you can't cope with. But I am suggesting just be honest about and own whatever your emotional state is and just be aware, because other people will sense it regardless.
I think being, emotional is it's energy. So the way I try to do it, I'm a work in progress, is with exactly what you say, why are you being emotional instead of being passionate? So as a work in progress, any kind of emotion actually is energy. So if we are conscious to actually harness that energy into something that's positive that you can control, if you can control your emotions, you have to first control yourself. And sometimes in being emotional, or that tag or that adjective of saying that you're emotional, is looked at as a weakness. Gosh, you can't hold yourself together. So, but then, there's also, being vulnerable is also actually a innate strengths. So, but you have to be able to see where and within what context you can show your emotion, but you will be able to discern where that is. Now, if you're in a room full of men who do not normally, you know, put their hearts on the sleeve or cry, then it really isn't a good situation for you to be doing any kind of a, be in an emotional state. So I think it's really being to recognize it at first, because when you recognize it, you actually see it and you call it out to yourself silently. And you're able to control it. And there's one thing that I learned. What other people think about you is none of your business. That is the number one thing. People can always think about so many things, can say so many things about you and have so many opinions about you. But it is none of your business what they think about. So I think with that one, that takes off a lot of pressure, because it really doesn't matter. As long as you're focused in what you're doing, you do it with integrity, you are passionate in what you're doing and you're loving what you do, people will see it and you will naturally attract the right people who don't say, why are you being so emotional? The right, but then you start attracting the right people because of the energy that you actually put out that's positive. And all of us is a work in progress, and we always learn. I'm a work in progress, and I always learn. Because, you know, being emotional sometimes, it really is being passionate, but knowing how to harness that and make it, you know, work for you in a good way.
Before you reply, Myla, let me just mention one of the phrases that is usually used to describe us. We call us cold bitch, you know, because sometimes we're so in control of our emotions, but it's so unnatural to the boss that they put us in.
Yeah.
That they actually say, okay, you're not being yourself, you're controlling, you're being a cold bitch. Have you been in that situation, and how did you handle it?
No, I think show it when I do. And I'm a very balanced person otherwise. So the difference when I become emotional or passionate, I like the word better, they know I mean business, right? So I think to answer, I let it come naturally, except again the crying part. I think that shows a level of immaturity. It's okay maybe. But if you can control that and harness, like you said, I think it makes you a genuine person. Another thing I try to do when I'm in that state is to try to stay on the ball as to what is the real issue at hand. Mm-hmm. And as long as you can focus on it, it becomes passion, not just plain.
Can we have one last question? Sorry, we're running out of time, but we can chat with our panelists.
I just wonder, my name is Lisa Pancalino, and I work in the environmental field, development. I was just wondering what advice you have on negotiating salaries and benefits, because I feel like I've been doing it wrong kind of my whole career, and I don't really know how to change.
My advice to you is to be incredibly transparent and honest with people from the outset. I realize that's difficult when you are a manager who is dealing with a budget and you have a limited pool from which you are able to allocate salaries or promotions. And sorry, I'm talking about a review process here, and you may also want advice from the other panelists on actually negotiating contracts. But certainly, when you're giving somebody a performance review, I think being honest, and what I say to my team always, is I start with this, and it's completely honest, which is, you know, ultimately, money is absolutely the motivator for all of us, because all of us have mortgages, things that we need to pay off, and just day-to-day living expenses. However, it should not be the driver for the reason that you come to work. And if it is, you should be having a conversation with yourself or having a look at the work that you're doing. And it's fine for me to say that. I know I'm a CEO of a bank, so people do assume that there's a, you know, there's the salary associated with that. But honestly, if that's one thing that I've learned, it's being honest with people about it. So you may well have an expectation around pay. I will do what I can to be able to help you with that. But are there other ways that you can find this work satisfying, that I can help to structure a package, or I can help to review your position, that would make this place a better place for you to work? And being honest with them, I'm trying to find out what motivates them, what they're interested in. And I know that it's, you know, I care about this because it's something that I've come across quite a lot in corporate world, which is people basically have a target that they need to meet, and then the salary just is commensurate with that. Nobody has a conversation with people about, what are you doing here? Do you enjoy your job? How can I make this a better place for you to work? When you turn the conversation around, even when you're negotiating a contract, you try and understand what it is that they actually want, because people don't just want money. They want something more than that. They want a job that they feel has purpose, is interesting, they will be respected professionally, and that there is a path for growth for them personally. And to me, and that's been my experience, because I'm a normal human being. So, you know, I think that if you treat people with respect as part of that, you will end up with a better outcome for your organisation and for the person involved.
I totally agree with you, Anne. People come to work because they want to have something to wake up for in the morning and say, yes, I gotta do this today. And that's what we try to put in our workplace. We give them space to grow. We're very proud that four of our original cabin crew that joined us in Clark 6 years ago have now got their pilot license and are flying. They're flying now. So two women and two men who were cabin crew. We're trying to accelerate more women into the cockpit, because that's really been the macho place in the airline. And I can proudly say that today, I check the figures periodically, like every 6 months, to see the ratio of the gender. And today, I reported at the Phoenix that we have 10% of our pilots are women in the Philippines. Yes, yeah, it's a good number, which is higher than the average of the group. The Philippine average, I think, in 2016 was like 2%. So these are things that you can measure. So you want your employees to know that they can strive for other jobs within the organization, that there is room for them to grow. If a baggage boy wants to be a pilot, we'll find ways to make that happen for him. If he has the aptitude for it and is willing to work hard for it, or she has the aptitude for it and willing to work hard for it. Because I think people will stay in the job not just for the money. Money is important. We know that. We have to bring, send children to school, feed our families and all that. But there are many other things in a job, as Anne said, you know, that makes it worth for you. And especially when you know that the work you're doing is doing something for other people. Like, we're not just selling airline seats. We're allowing people to connect with other people, for families to get together, and for people to be able to live their lives and broaden their world. That's how we look at our work.
Okay, I see we have 1 minute. So I'll just leave you with a guiding principle that I've had in the area of hiring process. I have never, ever been afraid to hire people who are better than me. And I think that guiding principle has allowed me to attract the most wonderful employees who in turn inspire me as a leader. So I've always lived by that, and I think you should consider that every time you are talking to someone you're considering to hire.
Let me add
just flip that question for a bit. Do you make it a point to hire women?
No. You do?
And the reason I do is just because the statistics around it are so massively weighted in favor of men that for me, whilst it will not be about hiring a woman simply because she's a woman, I will at least start, and in fact ANZ has a policy around all managerial positions must have at least one female candidate. So you must start, and that really even just helps the, I guess, the groundswell of women doing interviews to learn and to grow. And yes, you may not get the interview the first time, but at least do the interview. So I actually proactively try. And if there are two candidates with the same qualification standards, I would go for the woman simply on the basis that it's, you know, it's time.
I agree with her completely. So as a matter of fact, I had a conversation with the head of our people department. Our HR is not called HR, they're called people department. And with our CEO. Our CEO is a flying captain. And I said, we need to drive this gender diversity forward. And we need to have, in the hiring process, make sure that there are a lot of women candidates in, because you have to stop the pipeline. A lot of women come in on entry level, but as they go higher up in the level, some women have to opt out because of to take time out to raise children and all that. So you have to make sure that when you're hiring managers, you have to have at least an equal number of candidates that are interviewed. I was telling Captain Dexter, make sure that when you talk to a headhunter, you tell them that in the final shortlist, to give you at least, you know, 50% men, 50% women on the short list for you to do the final interview. I don't know, people say quotas are not right, but you need to give the women a chance to get in, because along the way, it's really harder for women to get in into the corporate world. But at the end of the day, you know, they must qualify.
We're running out of time, but let me just throw one last question that might, you know, trigger more conversations after this event. This question: would you rather, at least in the workplace, would you rather be loved than feared?
Feared.
Yeah.
Loved.
Yeah.
For sure.
Loved for sure, because actually in our team, I think the very basic driver of many things will go beyond, bend backwards, everything. The very basic is really love. So first, if you love what you do, it really doesn't matter what time it is. It really doesn't matter how much. The pay matters, but then that is not the ultimate. And if you actually have this vision where your whole team looks at that same vision and all of you are actually aligned, they end up loving what they do. If they have an impact, similar to what we're doing now as a social enterprise, they see that everything that we do has an impact on somebody else. I mean, the basic of that really is love. Love for another person, that my value in working in this social enterprise actually has an impact and somebody benefits from my talent. And in the very basic there is really love your neighbor. You have a love to actually exploit your own talents so you can take advantage of that to help somebody else. So between love and fear, fear can only last maybe a certain time, but then they're going to slack off because, oh my gosh, I have to stand at attention because I'm fearful my boss is there. But with love, they do anything, everything. There's no time. They don't eat. Doesn't matter what time. If they need to do anything, they will do it for you without even asking. They will take the initiative. This happens for my team. They will take the initiative to say, you know, Ms. Beth, we need to do this. You know, I saw this. I think we need to do this. So it really is love. That's the very basic thing. And everything that you do, if you do it with love, it will show. You will naturally attract a lot of other people.
Yeah, I think if you think about it, love inspires. I don't think fear inspires.
Yeah.
It's just that simple, right? But curious to know also if you had a panel of men, what would that answer?
What did they say?
The answer would be
you
rip
her off.
Yeah. I'm writing a book on Philippine folklore. So I've been going around and talking to real tycoons. Common denominator, they'd rather be feared.
Really?
Yes, because it gets things done.
I'll never be a male tycoon.
No, I don't think so. Tony Kuwanko would, I think, rather be loved. Tony Fernandez definitely is loved. Kamarudin would rather be loved. No, I think our men like to be loved.
Just a final point on that. I think your workforce will also reflect that.
Yeah.
So you're going to have, if you are someone who wants to lead with love and collaboration, then you will attract, as we've all said, the type of people who want to work in that environment. And to me, I don't care if I'm a tycoon or not. I'm surrounded by people and we all have a common purpose and respect each other. It's a gift to go to work.
Asiasociety.org/Philippines. Thank you so much and have a good evening.